side of the church. You guys on this side, stand up, grab a songbook, 644, verse number 2. How sweet the living water from the hills of God.
How sweet the living water from the hills of God.
To focus on food a little bit. 291. Come and die, come and die. The master calls. Sing on that first verse.
Jesus has the angels in, where the saints of God are fed. He invites his chosen people. Come and die. In his vanity defeat, and supplies are every need. For the streams of with Jesus all the time. Come and die, the master calls.
Sweet Spirit. I'm thankful God gave us His Holy Spirit. We're going to sing about it tonight.
Rose up.
thankful for the Holy Spirit. I'm thankful that God didn't just hide things from us. I'm glad He gave us His Word to show us all about that, all we need to know about His comfort and what He was promising. It is no secret what God can do. Go ahead and stand. 566 in your songbook. We're just going to sing the chorus on this one. 566. It is no secret what God can do.
I want to be faithful too. Appreciate that. I tell you what, church is the best part of the week to me. We get to come and worship the Lord and see one another, and now see a church that is almost equally dispersed amongst the people. A little bit ago, it was just you over here, and now we have some over here. Appreciate that. And just good to be in church. Good to be in church. You know, I get encouraged. If you live anything close to living for God, this world can be very discouraging. Yet you can come to church and you can see other believers who are struggling the way you're struggling, and you can see folks with smiles on their face, and see folks, you know, they've had to rush through traffic to get here, and I appreciate you being here. I want to just kind of put a plug in for Sunday school. I want to encourage you all to be in Sunday school. You know, we're doing the men and women classes right now until the first Sunday of June. We got other things planned starting the first Sunday in June. Just be here, be faithful to Sunday school. You watching by live stream, it's time to come back to Sunday school. So be here for Sunday school starting June, the first Sunday in June. I don't know what that date is. June something or another. It's the first Sunday in June, and looking forward to all of that. There'll be more details coming out soon. And then tomorrow night, remember, please, the fundraiser at Culver's. From 6 to 8 o'clock, wear your blue Do Love Walk shirt and bring one of these flyers with you. Bring a guest with you. Or, you know, maybe you told somebody in the past few weeks or months, you know, I want to take you out to eat. Tomorrow night is the best night to take that person out to eat, because you'll spend more money and you'll get some good food. That's right. Yeah, you can come just from 6 to 6:05 if you eat quick. just come and be a part, and that'd be good. I look forward to seeing you all there. And I'm not going to have lunch so I can spend more money for supper on that Sunday night. All right, find in your Bible, please, the book of Hosea. The book of Hosea. Way over in the Old Testament. In case you've forgotten about the Old Testament, it's in there too. You know, we preached this morning about marriage. Today is Marriage Refreshment Day, and this morning I preached on one word that every marriage ought to have, and it's the word commitment. And I hope the Lord blessed you and helped you through all that. And tonight, I want to do my best tonight to be very practical. I said somebody on the way out of church this morning said, I wish I could have heard a sermon like that when I was younger. And I said, well, praise the Lord. You're still here. But I hope tonight to give us all some advice, both to the husband and to the wife. I think I'll be very practical and be very helpful. And I can't make you a promise, or I can't make you a guarantee. I'm not that kind of person. But I will say this, you can be a blessing to your spouse if we'll apply the last 6 points of the sermon to your marriage, okay? So we're going to talk about that in a moment. And I want to say a few things up front. I believe, and you know how I feel about this, I believe the marriage is the number one relationship in the home. More important than you being the parent you are is you being the spouse you are. And your spouse ought to get your attention. Your spouse ought to be the most important person in your life. And we can give, probably all give testimony about how we've not always done the best we can in that area. And we maybe spend the first 20 years of our life so focused on working and so focused on raising the kids that when the kids are gone and all that's left is husband and wife, then things aren't what they should be. And I want to propose to you tonight that's not the way it's supposed to be. Now, your wife, your husband ought to be the most important person in your life. And when you spend all of your time revolve around the children or around the job, around whatever, then your spouse pays the price. Pays the price. Look in verse number 5 of Hosea. You can stay in your seat. I want to ask you to just remain seated, and I pray that you listen tonight. Listen, even if you're not married, listen, because hopefully one day you will. I was talking this morning to one of our kids at church. He was walking over yonder to the gym, and I said, one day you're going to get married, and you're going to think about what I said today. And they looked at me like, you're crazy. I'm not getting married, but I bet you they will. I bet you they will. All right. The book of Hosea, look in verse 5 of chapter 2, please. Just a little bit of a background. These are the words of Hosea, and Hosea speaking, and in your mind, imagine Hosea speaking to his wife who's committed adultery. She's lived a very wicked life, and it's also the Lord speaking to Israel about what Israel's been doing. But look in verse 5, please, Hosea chapter 2. The Bible says, for their mother hath played the harlot. She that conceived them hath done shamefully, for she said, I will go after my lovers that give me my bread and my water, my wool and my flax, mine oil and my drink. Therefore, behold, I will hedge up thy way with thorns. I will make a wall that she shall not find her path. She shall follow after her lovers, but she shall not overtake them. She shall seek them, but shall not find them. Then shall she say, I will go and return to my first husband, for then it was better with me than now. Interesting. She's learned her lesson. Verse 8. For she did know that I gave her corn and wine and oil and multiplied her silver and gold, which they prepared for Baal. Therefore will I return and take away my corn and the time thereof, and my wine and the season thereof, and will recover my wool and my flax given to cover her nakedness. Verse 10. And now will I discover her lewdness in the sight of her lovers, and none shall deliver her out of mine hand. I will also cause all her mirth to cease, her feast days, her new moons, her Sabbaths, and all her solemn feasts. I will destroy her vines and her fig trees, whereof she hath said, these are my rewards that my lovers have given me, and I will make them a forest, and the beast of the field shall eat them. And I will visit upon her the days of Balaam, wherein she burned incense to them, and she decked herself with her earrings and her jewels, and she went after her lovers and forgot me, saith the Lord. Listen to the next few few verses, verse 14 and verse 17. Therefore, such an important word, therefore. A preacher one time said, when you see the word therefore, see what it's there for. And we see the word therefore meaning something's going to take place or happen. That's the result of the previous verses. Therefore, behold, I will allure her and bring her into the wilderness and speak comfortably unto her. And I will give her her vineyards from thence in the valley of Achor, the door of hope. And she shall sing there in the day, as in the days of her youth, as in the day when she came up out of the land of Egypt. And it shall be at that day, saith the Lord, that thou shalt call me Ishi, and shall call me no more Balaam. Verse 17. For I will take away the names of Balaam out of her mouth, and they shall no more be remembered by their name. I want to preach on this thought tonight. This is Marriage Refreshment Sunday. I want to speak on this thought, happily ever after. Happily ever after. You've all read a storybook or a poem or whatever, and at the end of it it'll say, and they lived happily ever after. That's not just for a storybook, church. That's for you. That's for me. God's promised us that we can live happily ever after in our marriage if we'll apply His principles to our marriage. Let's pray and ask God's blessings. Thank you, Lord, so much for your word tonight. I pray you may help as I preach. I pray, God, you may speak to our hearts. And I do pray again tonight, God, as I pray this morning for every home represented in our church tonight. I pray for every marriage that it is what it ought to be. I pray we husbands ought to be the husband we're supposed to be. I pray that our wives be the wives they're supposed to be. Then I pray for our young people, that they may see their mom and dad just love each other unconditionally. I pray that our marriages will be a good example to our children, and to our families. Bless your word tonight. And whatever you may do, we're going to be careful to give you glory for all of that. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, the story we read tonight is a very extreme case of what I'll call a marriage gone bad. And it's the story of a wife, and not only is it her name is Gomer, but we know that the Bible tells us she's an adulterous woman, and the husband, we know his name is Hosea, so we have Hosea the husband who's done his best to be what he's supposed to be, and here's his wife, Gomer, who has not been the wife that she's supposed to be, and we don't have time to read the whole book of Hosea, but at the end of the book of Hosea, we're going to read about how they get together, and it's a type of God's forgiveness. It's a type of God's unconditional love He has for His church. Because can I remind you, church, tonight, that you and I, we all fall short of the glory of God. And none of us are what we're supposed to be all the time. And we all need to be forgiven. We all need to have that unforgiving love that Christ has for His church. But notice about this lady Gomer, this man Hosea, this part of the story is a part of the story where the wife, the lady Gomer, she's not happy in her marriage. And the husband is no longer the head of his home. And can I say, when you and I get to the point in our life where we're no longer concerned about being the spouse we're supposed to be, then we are treading in very dangerous territory. Read a story about a man. He was at work and he decided that he was going to show his wife how much he still loved her. And before he went home, he showered and he shaved and put on her favorite cologne. He even stopped and bought her a bouquet of roses. And he went to the front door and rang the doorbell. He just stood there with roses in hand and a loving smile on his face. After a few moments, the wife, she opened the door and said, "Oh no, this has been a terrible day. First, I got to take Billy to the emergency room because he cut his leg. And then Sally, she brought home some bad grades from school, and the washing machine broke, and we can't afford a new one right now. And my mother-in-law called, and she's going to come and visit for 2 weeks. And now this, my husband's come home drunk." So she wasn't used to her husband trying to make her happy. But on another note, don't raise your hand, but you ever had this thought, or maybe felt your spouse had this thought, "I don't feel like I love you anymore. You don't treat me like you used to treat me. I love you, but I've had it. I want out. Or I found someone else." There's many enemies to the marriage, to the 2021 marriage. There's many enemies out there, but I wonder if enemy number one is not discontentment. We talked about this morning being committed, and come what may, you're committed to your spouse. Come whatever, come sickness, come health, come coronavirus, come bad times, come financial problems, come whatever, come what may, you are committed to your spouse, whatever happens. And I wonder, though, if one of the enemies of our homes, our marriages, is not that word discontentment. Just as important as commitment is to a marriage, I believe discontentment is that same amount dangerous. When there's discontentment, problems are soon to follow. I think it's what Gomer's dealing with. We're going to see it in a moment. She's discontent. She's not happy. She's unfulfilled. She's unsatisfied. I read these five principles about discontentment. I'm going to read these, and I think in just a moment I'm going to read them to you again because I want you to think about them. These five principles about discontentment in your marriage. Discontentment is an enemy that will turn your attention from what God intends your marriage to be to what the devil intends your marriage to be. Discontentment will lead you down a path that you thought you would never take. Discontentment, once engaged, is never satisfied. Discontentment is an illusion that clouds you from seeing what you really have. And discontentment begins in the mind, and it's played out in our actions. That being said, let's look at our outline tonight, please. Hope you all got one. I forgot to put them out earlier, and I think Joshua gave everybody one. If you don't have one, then it's all Joshua's fault. But hopefully you have one, all right? Look at number one. Just got two thoughts tonight, 2 points. Number one, what hurts a marriage? What hurts a marriage? Look in verse 5. For their mother hath played the harlot. She hath conceived them that had that done shamefully, for she said, I will go after my lovers, and will give me my bread and my water and my wool and my flax and my oil and my drink. What's happening here is she has hurt her marriage, and she's harmed her marriage. By the way, the next four principles, they are meant to be said about Gomer, the wife, but they could be true about the husband or the wife. First of all, Gomer, I just mentioned this, Gomer, first of all, was discontented. She was discontented. Let me read those five principles of discontentment one more time. Discontentment is an enemy that will turn your attention from what God intends your marriage to be to what the devil intends your marriage to be. Discontentment will lead you down a path that you thought you would never take. Discontentment, once engaged, is never satisfied. Discontentment is an illusion that God that clouds you from seeing what you really have. Let me read that one again. That's a good one. Discontentment is an illusion that clouds you from seeing what you really have. Number five, discontentment begins in the mind and is played out in the actions. Gomer is discontented. All those five things, if we could go back into time to about the year 785 B.C., we could ask Gomer these questions, and if she's honest, she would say, yes, that describes me. She's discontented. Unhappiness in a marriage can cause a person to do unspeakable things. Now, we understand Gomer. She's not the, how do I say this? She's not the most godly woman in the neighborhood. And she's not by any stretch of the imagination a pure woman, not at all, but she is a married woman. And she is supposed to be happy and content in her marriage. And we understand that she's not for whatever reason. And we don't read anything Hosea's done wrong to her. We don't read anything about Hosea stepping out or Hosea not meeting her needs or Hosea not fulfilling his role as a husband. We don't read anything like that. All we read about is the Bible says that Gomer, the wife, she's taken to these strange men. And so she's discontented. Number two, in verse 7, Gomer is also disloyal. In verse 7, and she shall follow after her lovers, but she shall not overtake them, and she shall seek them, but shall not find them. Then shall she say, I will go and return to my first husband, for then it was better with me than now. Once discontentment settles in, then disloyalty starts. Once we have in our minds, in your marriage, discontentment, then disloyalty will soon begin to take place. It's true about many things in life. Think about the job that you have or you used to have or you'd like to have or the job that you just left or whatever. When you begin on your job to be unhappy on your job, you know what you do? You stop working so hard. When you begin to get unhappy in your job, you begin to, maybe you used to get to work 10 minutes early, now you get to work 5 minutes early, or right on time, or 5 minutes late. When you were happy on your job, you would obey your boss and do what your boss said, and you would do your best to be a good employee, but now you just kind of eke by looking for Friday. It's one thing to not be happy on a job and begin looking for another job, but it's completely different to be unhappy in your marriage and look for somebody else. I read the article, and here's what the article said, and it was really, and actually we're talking about, in the article, talking about this situation in Hosea. Here's what the writer said. He said, once a person steps outside their marriage for the first time, the second time will be much easier. Look in verse 7. And she shall follow after her, what's the next word? Lovers, plural. One time wasn't enough. One boyfriend wasn't enough. One act of adultery was enough. It was over and over and over again. The Bible says she shall follow after them, but she shall overtake them. And she shall seek them and shall not find them. And then shall she say, well, I'll just go back to my first husband because it was better then than it is now. She's realized that her husband wasn't as bad as she thought he was. I know several people that have been disloyal to their spouse. And I've heard them even say, well, I just wasn't happy. And I want to say, well, so what? Show me in the Bible where God says, thou shalt be happy. I don't read that in my King James Bible where I'm supposed to be happy. But you know what I'm supposed to do? I'm supposed to be faithful. So with that being said, can I say this? While we're not told that we're to be happy, we are told to do our best to be committed to our marriage. And I thought about this. We'll do whatever it takes to make our spouse happy. Amen. Thank you, Brother Roger. If your spouse, let's say you're the person in your family, you know, you used to say, you know, you're the wife and you cook the food, but now sometimes it's the dad who cooks the food, but whoever cooks the food in your house, if your spouse likes the food cooked a certain way, then by all means, just cook it that way, you know? If your spouse likes things done a certain way, then just do it a certain way. If there's things about you that gets on your spouse's nerves, listen, church, stop doing it. If there's things you know your spouse likes and they like for you to do those, then by all means, just do those things. Because an unhappy spouse, like Gomer, could turn into an unfaithful spouse. Number three, Gomer was depleted. She was discontented, disloyal, and she was depleted. The Bible says she's following after her lovers, and she shall not overtake them. She shall seek them, but shall not find them. Then she shall say, finally. She says this, I'm tired of chasing after that guy and that guy and that guy. And the husband may say, I'm tired of chasing after that lady and that lady and that lady. Here's what she says, I'm just gonna go back and go back to my husband, for then it was better than with me now. She's depleted. She's been chasing around other men and she can't seem to find any man to make her happy. She's in a relationship with other people, but none of them make her feel like Hosea made her feel. None of these other lovers loved her the way Hosea loved her. She's unhappy. She's discontented. And now she's come up empty. She's going to realize sooner or later that the grass is not greener on the other side of the fence. All she did was waste her time and waste her energy, and now she's depleted. And I know folks like this. I know folks who, when they're married, they're so unhappy, they're so discontented, they're so drained, they're so discouraged that it has just zapped all strength from them. And one of them has even said to me lately, "I just can't go on in this relationship anymore." I wrote this down. Don't allow discontentment about what you don't have ruin what you do have. Don't allow the discontentment about what you don't have ruin what you do have. What a shame for a husband or a wife to be so selfish and to be so prideful that they're going to destroy their entire family and destroy their home and damage their children because they're not happy. Who told you you're supposed to be happy? So she was discontented, disloyal, depleted. Number four, she was disillusioned. Look in verse 8. "For she did know that I gave her corn and oil and and wine and oil and multiplied her silver and gold, which they prepared for Baal." She realized in verse 8 that her lovers weren't the ones taking care of her. It was her husband. Her lovers wanted one thing from her, but Hosea wanted her. Let me say it again. Her lovers, those men she was chasing around, they wanted one thing from her, but Hosea wanted her. You know what the devil is? He's the great deceiver. And the devil can put thoughts in a husband or a wife's mind that'll cause them to stray. That'll cause them to do what Gomer's doing here and to be chasing after other people. But remember now, if the thought comes from the devil, it is a lie. He is a liar. He's a father of lies. There's no truth in anything the devil says. Remember what he told Eve? He says, "God didn't say that." He was deceiving her. The devil's always trying to deceive you in your marriage. He's trying to tell you that, yes, maybe the grass is greener over there. And yes, maybe that other woman may take care of you better. Or the other man may take care of you better. Or you'll be happy over there. Or happy over there. Or happy with that person. And happy with that person. Listen, that's all a lie from the devil. And if it comes from the devil's mouth, it comes straight from the pits of hell. The devil is a liar. Don't let him deceive you in thinking that the grass is greener in somebody else's yard. The other woman, the other man, will not make you happy. They'll make you miserable. Gomer learned in verse 7 that I'm just going to go back to my husband. It was better then than it is now. Why in the world, I may have said this before, this just kind of sounds like something I would say. Why in the world would a man want a bologna sandwich when he has T-bone steak at home? That's good. Yeah. Write that down. Yeah. Why would a man or a woman want a bologna sandwich at somebody else's house when back at their own house they have T-bone steak? I'll tell you why. Because they're discontented. They're disloyal. They're depleted. They're disillusioned. And they think something like this. Well, what if the grass may be greener in their yard, but if you'd fertilize and water your grass, it'd be green too. That's good right there. That's good. All right. Number one, what hurts a marriage? Secondly, this is where I want to be very practical, best I can. Number two, what helps a marriage? Well, look in verse 14 to verse 17. All the verse 5 to verse 13, that's all the bad news. That's Hosea, he's letting his wife have it. God's letting Israel have it for their unfaithfulness. And talking about, you've done this, you've done this, you've done this, you've done all this bad stuff. But here are the words of Hosea, who's Hosea, a man who unconditionally loves his wife. He loves her, wants her back, knowing what she's been doing and who she's been doing it with. He wants her back. Here's what he says in verse 14. Therefore, behold. In other words, in spite of what she's been doing, in spite of the bad things she's been doing, in spite of the men she's been chasing around, behold, I will allure her and bring her into the wilderness and speak comfortably unto her. And I will give her her vineyards from thence and the valley of Achor for the door of hope, and she shall sing there as in the days of her youth and as in the days when she came up out of the land of Egypt. Verse 16, and it shall be at that day, saith the Lord, that thou shalt call me Ishi and shalt no more call me Balaam. Verse 17, for I will take away the names of Balaam out of her mouth, and they shall no more be remembered by their name. If discontentment is what hurts a marriage, then how do we help our marriage? Well, let's do, if you're a husband, even if you're a wife, let's do what Hosea did. Let's, first of all, number one, initiate love towards your spouse. Initiate love towards your spouse. Nobody in their right mind could say this about Gomer. Boy, she loves her husband. I mean, you'd be insane to think Gomer loves her husband the way her husband loves her. We don't read that. We don't even read anywhere that Gomer says, honey, I'm sorry, please take me back. None of that. All we read is Gomer, she's out sowing her wild oats and in the other neighbor's yard, looking at the grass in the other neighbor's yard. She's over there messing around. She shouldn't be over there. But the reading verse 14, in spite of all what she's doing, here's what Hosea does. He allures her. Initiate love towards your spouse. Here's what he says. In spite of all that she's done wrong, and all that she's done bad, in spite of who she's been with, all she's been chasing around, here's what he says. I will allure her. Hosea didn't wait for Gomer to start loving him again. He took the first step. The word allure, it means to attract, to entice, or to tempt. Who likes to go fishing? I like to go fishing. What is the name of that thing you tie on the end of your line? It's called a lure. And you know what a good fisherman does is he ties on that lure and he ties it on real tight and he makes sure the thing's not going to come loose and he makes sure that that hook is super duper sharp. He ties the lure on very tight. He makes sure the hook is very, very sharp. You know what else he does sometimes? He'll take some of that stuff and he'll spray it on that lure. Because that stuff, I like that sound. That you're spraying on a lure, you can get it. This is how much of a fishing nerd I am. You can get it where it smells like a shad or like a crawdad, and you can spray it on your lure. And when that lure, and you throw it in that where those fish are, man, that bass, that fish, he can't stay away from it. It looks good to him. And also, it smells good to him. That which you think stinks, that dead shad, that crawfish, man, that bass, that big bass out there, he loves that stuff. That's good. He'll swim over there, and he'll bite. Guess what? Boom, you got him. You set the hook, and you got him. When was the last time you tried to allure your spouse? Put some of that good-smelling stuff on. Sharpen your hook. Make sure your line's tied tight. Somebody say amen right there. Because even when that fish isn't hungry, listen please, even when that fish isn't hungry, they can't not eat that lure with that stuff squirted on there. They just have to have it. You know what Hosea did? He
brushing his teeth. He's ready. He's trying to allure his woman, even though she don't deserve it. Even though she's been sowing her wild oats, even though she's been off somewhere else, he's trying to allure her. And even if she wasn't even hungry, she can't help but come home and spend some time with him. The word allure, it means to attract, to entice, or to tempt. Number two, what else can we do to help our marriage? Number two, insist on time alone with your spouse. Look in verse 14, continues, "Behold, I will allure her." From now on, every time you say that word allure, you're going to think about squirting stuff on there. Look at the second part of verse 14. "And bring her into the wilderness." He wants to take her somewhere where they can be all by themselves without the kids. That's what it says. Not really, but that's what I'm making it say. He wants it to be just him and his wife. Just him and his woman. He's done got his smell good stuff on. He's done brushed his teeth. He's done put on his deodorant. He's taken a bath. It's not even Saturday yet. I mean, he's ready for business, and he wants to be alone, just him and his wife, without the kids. I think every married couple ought to have at least one date night a week. That's what I think. It don't have to be a fancy restaurant. You know what could be? You know what could be a fun date? Sitting on the couch with a big old bowl of popcorn, watching Andy. Son, that's a date right there. Let me tell you. And cheap. If you have Netflix, it's really cheap. Dairy Queen without the kids can be very romantic. Somebody say amen right there. Anything without the kids can be very romantic. McDonald's, as gross as those chicken nuggets are, can be very romantic without the kids. Believe me, your kids will survive without you for 1 hour. You don't have to go out on a date, out to eat, go for a walk, go sit on the back porch, front porch, side porch. Just spend some time together. May say something like this: "Well, we don't have time to spend together." Are you serious? Do you not have 1 hour in the week to spend alone with your spouse? If not, this can be very mean, but if not, something's got to change. If you don't have 1 hour to spend with your wife or your husband, something's got to change. So he insists on time alone with his spouse. Number three, what else can we do? Impart love vocally. Impart love vocally. Look at verse 14 also. Here's what he says: "I will allure her and bring her into the wilderness." And here's what he says: "And speak comfortably unto her." That word in verse 14, the word comfortably, is the Hebrew word labe, and it means friendly, considerate, and in a kind and loving manner. Ephesians 4, verse 29 through 32 says, "Let no corrupt communication proceed out of thy mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers, and grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby we are sealed unto the day of redemption. Let all bitterness," listen carefully, "let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice." In verse 32, Ephesians 4:32, write it down, look at it later. "And be ye kind one to another." The next word is this: tenderhearted. Hosea, he wants to speak comfortably to his wife. I tell you what, he's more of a man than I am. I'd be mad. I'd be spitting nails. "What do you mean you've done that?" He says, "Honey, I love you. I forgive you. Come back home." Maybe the reason the spouse is discontented is because of the way you speak to them. Nothing gets on my nerves more than hear a husband or a wife speak down to his spouse or her spouse. I've heard it before in public. I've seen it in people I know. I just want to go up to that guy who's mistreated his wife, talk bad about his wife, and I want to go and just punch him in the face. I mean, in Christian love, obviously, but just take him, I mean, just give him, you know, give him a knuckle sandwich right in the middle of his face, knock a few teeth out. How dare you talk to your wife that way? I know some men who speak nicer to their dog than they do their wife. And wives, it's not just them. I've seen wives speak bad about their husbands and talk down to their husbands and boss their husbands around. And I, too, want to go to them and not punch them, maybe smack them, but you know what I'm saying, and say, how dare you speak to your husband that way? But you know what Hosea does? I love you, honey. I want you back. He speaks comfortably to her. Our spouses need to hear how much we love them. Our wife needs to hear how beautiful we think they are. We husbands need to hear how much of a hunk you think we still are. We need to speak nicely, compassionately, and lovingly to our spouse. In part, love vocally. Number four, invest in your love for your spouse. Look in verse 15. And I will give her vineyards from thence, and the valley of Achor from a door of hope, and she shall sing there as in the days of her youth. Listen, he wants her back so bad. Here's what he says: I'm going to buy her a vineyard. You imagine that? He loves her so much. After all he's done to him, he wants her back. He says, come home, honey. It's okay. I love you. I'll buy you a vineyard. Now, wives today would say, I don't want no vineyard. I want a big old ring. Or I want a new car. I want a big house. I want whatever. But he loves her so much. He's forgiven her. He's been comfortably in her. He says, honey, come on home. I'll buy you a vineyard. You know what he's doing? He's investing in his love for his spouse. She doesn't deserve it, but she still gets it. When was the last time you, for your spouse, your wife, or your husband, just did something for her just because? And not just because it's Valentine's Day. Just because it's her birthday, or Mother's Day, or Father's Day, or anniversary. What about a day of the week that would just blow her doors off? What about Tuesday? Tuesday, such a lame day. Tuesday. What about Tuesday? You stop by Walmart and buy your wife or your husband their favorite candy. Just a $2 Milky Way bar. Say, here, honey, I love you. She may go, whoa, whoa. Not quite a vineyard, but I'll take it. What kind of ice cream does your spouse like? Me too, Brother Roger. I do too. What kind of candy does she like? When was the last time you just said, you know, honey, tonight, here, honey, you had the remote. After she passed out, she said, oh, thank you. You know, I'm talking about investing in your marriage. Number five, what else can we do? Inspire each other. Verse 15 continues. Look what he says. I'm going to buy her a vineyard. I'm going to make her so happy. She shall sing there as in the days of her youth. He wants to love on her so much that in her mind she's thinking, man, this is how it was. Listen, when we were dating. He says, I want to make her sing like she did when she was on her honeymoon. Nothing we can do to make our spouse any younger. But I wonder what we can do to make them feel younger. I wrote these few things down. Guys, it's us guys. Put a smile on her face. Write her a note. Send her a text. Buy her some flowers. Or some chocolate. Every lady likes chocolate, don't they? Take her out on a date. Here you go. Put a song in her heart. Ladies, put a smile on his face. Tell him how handsome he is. And while you're doing so, have your fingers crossed behind your back. Cook him his favorite meal. Take care of his needs. Put a song in his heart. Number six, finally, Initiate love toward your spouse. Insist on time alone with your spouse. Impart love vocally. Invest in your love for your spouse. Inspire each other. Number six. And probably most importantly, be in love with each other. Be in love with each other. Verse 16. And it shall be in that day, after Hosea did 1 through 5, as in that day, remember now, no matter what she's done, she don't deserve it. Lord knows she don't deserve it. She's been a bad lady. She's gone off with other guys. He wants her back. He sweet talks her. He buys her a vineyard. He buys her a candy bar. They sit on the couch and eat popcorn and watch Andy. They're having a great time. Verse 16, and it shall be in that day, saith the Lord, that thou shalt call me Ishi, and shalt no more call me Baali. For I will take away the names of Balaam out of her mouth, and they shall be no more remembered by their name. That word Ishi means husband. And that word Baali means my Lord. And here's where I'm going. In this day, when this was written, I mean the wife, she was to bow down and serve her husband like a lord. But Hosea's intention is not to be served. His intention is to love his wife and take care of his wife and be kind to his wife. And she would be, he would be to her like a husband and not like a master. I don't know if it's true in your marriage, but it's true in my marriage. The best part of my day is when it's just me and Beth. The boys are whatever they're doing, working, whatever. Playing video games, doing homework, wherever, who cares? And it's just me and her on the couch with that bowl of popcorn watching Andy or Joanna Gaines or Braves or whatever we watch. That's just the best part of our day. And I wonder, is that the best part of your day? Best part of my day is when I'm at work because I ain't with her. Goodness gracious. Best part of my day is when he's at work because I ain't got to see him and I ain't got to talk to him and I ain't got to look at him. Best part of our day is when we're apart. Listen, that's no way it ought to be. Best part of your day is when you're together. You know what Hosea wanted to do? He just wanted to be with his wife more than anything else. He didn't want to be her master. He didn't want to be her Lord. He wanted to be her husband. Her husband. That phrase, they live happily ever after. It's not just for a storybook. It's for all of our marriages. Let's bow our heads, please. And our eyes are closed, our heads are bowed as we have invitation tonight. I wonder if the Lord has spoken to you about your marriage. I'll reiterate it when I say this. There's no greater relationship in the home than that of the marriage. And the kids need to see mom loving dad and dad loving mom no matter what. The most important example your kids will see, your grandkids will see about a marriage comes from you. If they get their idea of what a marriage is comes from a TV, then Lord help them. If they get their idea of what a marriage is from what they see on Instagram or Facebook or TikTok or one of the other things, then Lord help us. They ought to know what a marriage is based upon you, mom, and you, dad. What kind of example are you setting for your children? Maybe some husbands and wives need to come to the altar and pray, or right there in your seat, pray and say something like this, Lord, help our marriage be what it's supposed to be. Maybe some young folks need to come to the altar and pray for their parents. Maybe some grandparents need to come pray for their grandkids. If the Lord touched your heart, I want to invite you to come to the altar and pray and ask Him to help you.